Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. My name is Minina Chow, and I welcome you to this SAP community call. With me is Holger Handel. He is product manager for SAP Analytics Cloud, and he focuses on the planning capabilities of the product. So you see, the topic of today is business content for workforce planning. And as always, this session is a recorded one with an interactive part at the end where we will address questions that you may raise. So feel free to already put them in the Q&A button, like post your questions and we can get to them at the end. With that, Holger, I'm handing over to you.
Yeah, thanks, Minina. Also welcome from my side. As mentioned, my name is Holger Handel. I work here in the product management team for SAP Analytics Cloud, and here I'm responsible for the planning component inside SAC. And the topic of today is the new business content, which we are about to release in basically next month, so in August. And I would like to introduce you to this new business content, which is focusing on the workforce planning. Yeah, as you all know, SAP Analytics Cloud is basically SAP's strategic platform for everything around analytics. So we have very strong business intelligence capabilities. So this is all around dashboarding, data visualization, data exploration. And then we have also augmented analytics capabilities. So this is everything related to predictive analytics, where we leverage things like machine learning, predictive capabilities in order to support the information worker and to find out things in a more automated way compared to, let's say, traditional methods like slicing and dicing in a manual way. And this is also something which is actually heavily requested now by many customers. And the third functional pillar is actually enterprise planning. So SAC is not just a BI and analytics platform, but we provide also very strong capabilities for customers to implement planning processes using SAC. And by the way, I think a few people know that SAC actually started as a planning solution. Back then it was called Cloud for Planning. So it was actually intended to be the successor in the cloud for our planning products. And today we want to focus on the planning in particular and on the workforce planning topic. There's also a reason for that. We offered in the past dedicated workforce planning capabilities as part of our SuccessFactors suite. And these products or these modules have been sunset beginning of the year. So there is actually no dedicated headcount or workforce planning module anymore in SuccessFactors. But the recommendation for our customers is to use SAC and to support our customers implementing SAC for workforce planning. We basically now provide also business content which can be leveraged out of the box. In general, SAC is more of a general purpose planning platform. So we provide certain capabilities which are shown here on the left-hand side. So we have a modeling environment where customers can create their data models, where you can define your planning drivers, for example, but where you can also integrate with data sources, so where you can maintain your master data and your actual data. Besides that, we provide capabilities to orchestrate and monitor the planning process. So this capability is in our tool provided by the planning calendar, where you can actually set up the process, so you can define tasks and responsibilities, and you can also then assign these tasks to the individual people in your organization, and then also monitor the progress of your whole process. Then we have a lot of capabilities around plan data entry, or when it comes to the actual activity of the end user, so the individual planner in the organization. So here we provide technologies like the predictive capability I've just mentioned, which can be used, for example, to initialize the plan, so to provide a baseline in an automated way. But we also provide, of course, traditional planning functions like, let's say, disaggregation from top to bottom, or we provide also mechanisms to copy data or to provide or implement a custom business logic in form of our data actions. So this is especially useful because in many planning applications, you want to apply certain calculation logic. Take, for example, workforce planning now, typically you have certain methodologies to calculate your personal costs, like, for example, social security contributions or taxes. And sometimes there are also heavy calculations involved. And here we provide also mechanisms so that you can implement these kind of calculations. Then, since we are here directly integrated with the BI capabilities, we have, of course, then also a lot of functions when it comes to reporting and data visualizations. So here you can basically leverage everything coming from the BI part, so all the widgets, all the data exploration and data visualization capabilities. And this is especially useful in the planning context, on the one hand side to analyze, let's say, actual data, but also to do things like actual plan comparison later on, so that you can see that your plan evolves like you have set up initially. And then finally, there are also capabilities for submission of the plan. So typically at the end of a planning process, users need to submit the data. Data logs need to be applied so that no one can make changes to the data anymore. And then you want to finalize the process. Amongst these capabilities, we have also very strong collaboration capabilities. Since planning is a very collaborative process, you can basically share stories. You can initiate discussions with our discussion tool, or you can also use things like the data commenting functionality, where you can actually put your rationale behind the numbers. And these capabilities apply more or less to all individual functional areas. So whether this is a financial planning process or an HR planning process, we can basically leverage these set of capabilities. So on that aspect, SAC basically provides this general planning platform, general purpose planning platform, where you can use SAC for definitely or for all sorts of planning processes in an organization. So SAC does not come with a particular process in mind. So there are other tools in the market who focus on a certain financial planning process or focus dedicatedly on an HR planning process. So SAC is more as a general planning platform where you can also then implement all these kind of planning processes. And this is also especially important because typically planning is not isolated, but typically the different planning processes integrate with each other. So if you think about a sales planning process where you plan, let's say, the quantities of your products you want to sell in the future, you'd also have then directly an impact on your P&L, on your revenues you generate, but you have also an impact on your, let's say, on your workforce, because if you introduce a new product or if you want to increase the sales quantities, you need to make sure that you have enough salespeople in your organization. So here with this simple example, you can already see that all these different functional areas are typically also connected with each other. And so that if you plan in one area, you typically have also an impact on another area. And this concept we also call XPNA, Extended Planning and Analysis. So this means we basically transfer a concept which you might know as financial planning and analysis from the finance domain also to other functional areas, like to the HR area or the sales area. And SAC, from our perspective, is the platform where you can implement all these kinds of different planning processes. And with that, of course, you need to also integrate amongst these planning processes, but you need to, of course, also integrate back into the source system where the, let's say, the reference data is provided. For example, on the financial planning side, you want to integrate with your existing chart of account, which is typically maintained in your finance system. And on this, let's say, workforce planning side, you want to have all the employee master data, like, for example, the pay grade, the job functions, and so on. So here, of course, you need to integrate then with your HR system of record. And this concept of XPNA also indicates why, from our perspective, planning should typically take place in a common platform and not, let's say, in the silo of your transactional system, because then it's really difficult to integrate, let's say, your HR plan with your financial plan. If you bring these planning applications here to a common platform, then it's actually a lot easier to integrate these different planning processes with each other. And in order to support this, we actually provide business content And the topic of today is actually the business content in the HR area for workforce planning. But in general, since SAC comes as a, let's say, as a toolkit or as a platform, we of course want to provide also here content which can be used by customers to accelerate their implementation processes so that you do not need to start from scratch with an empty box, but you have already templates and best practices in place so that you can actually directly start using the product. We have already provided a lot of content in the financial area. So we have a very rich set of templates in the area of financial planning, covering everything around cost center planning, product cost planning, financial statement planning, and so on. And now with QSC 3, we are also shipping now a new content package for workforce planning, which is more about all the, let's say, topics of an operational headcount planning process. So here it's about setting FTE and headcount targets, breaking this down into the organization, but then also plan individual activities like promotions, salary adjustments for individual employees, and also the planning of new positions. And this is actually, as I mentioned, part of our business content library, which you can directly activate in SAC. So every tenant comes with a connection to our content library, and every customer of SAC can then directly leverage the content. So you do not need to download the content from a website and import it into SAC. You can just go to the business content library inside SAC and activate the content package. The content itself, as I mentioned, or the target of this content package is that we support our customers building up this integrated XP&A landscape so that you can basically use it to implement your workforce planning. So we have all these standard business logics here included. But since at the end, or our vision is that customers build up these integrated planning processes, of course, we build the content in such a way that you can also integrate with, for example, the financial planning content. So in general, from a strategic perspective, this is also our goal, that all these planning content packages can be used, let's say, for their particular special purpose. So here, workforce planning, and that you can also then leverage the connectivity to the source system, in this case SuccessFactors Employee Central. But of course, the content is built in a modular way so that you can also connect the different functional content packages, like here in our example, we can connect workforce planning to financial planning. The workforce planning content in particular leverages here also new functionalities like the new model. So we have built here the content on top of one data model, which covers then the individual scenarios within workforce planning. For example, we have here one model for top-down and bottom-up planning so that you can also leverage then the model, let's say, in other planning areas, not just the one we have built here, but in the future, we also want to ship, let's say, more processes built on top of this model. The model and let's say the content itself is built in a very flexible way so that you can also easily extend it. As I mentioned, the content serves more the purpose of a template. So now if customers want to adjust the content to their particular needs, then we also provide certain guidance how you can adjust that. So for example, if you have a different set of pay components, not the one which are part of the standard, then it's quite easy to adjust to this, let's say, individual master data you have on your side. The same is true with customization in general. So let's say if you want to provide a different way to calculate costs, then it's quite easy to adjust the business logic in a certain way. For example, if you want to differentiate how, let's say, retirement or contributions to a retirement plan is done in different countries, then you can actually adjust the respective business logic for this part of the cost calculation. Since there are many different processes when it comes to workforce planning, it's also important to know what is actually not covered here with the business content package. And this is actually shown here in this slide. We focus here on operational workforce planning. So this is typically a process which looks into, let's say, the next 6 to 24 months. And typically you plan here headcount and FTE and the related personal expenses for your organization. we do not cover in this package the topic of strategic workforce planning, because there is already another package out which covers that one. So strategic workforce planning is more looking into a multi-year period. And typically you also cover more or you want to look more into skills of your workforce, and you look into certain trends like attritions and let's say retirements. So this is already covered here in the strategic workforce planning content. On the other end, we have also typically very operational processes when it really comes to operational scheduling. So let's assume we have here a manufacturing company and you want to stuff the individual shifts of your assembly line, or if you're an airline and you need to stuff the crew for your flights, this is very typically a very, very operational exercise, which typically also happens on a daily basis or even lower than that. And this is also something we do not cover here in our operational workforce planning content package. What we cover is, two flavors of operational workforce planning. So we have included, applications and business logic for top-down planning or for an aggregated planning. So here you typically plan headcount on an organizational level, on an aggregated level for a whole business unit. And then you can also calculate the costs on this level. And this is typically then the target setting for a bottom-up approach, or it's used then with an automated breakdown to break this down to the individual organizational units like the company codes, or even down to the cost centers and department level. On the other hand, we support this bottom-up planning where you're planning on more details. So here, the persona is typically the manager of a department or of a cost center who has direct reports, and he or she plans then things like long-term absences, like for example, a parental leave, terminations or internal transfers, but also typically you plan new vacancies, so new positions. And you also, of course, want to then derive the related costs, like for example, if you plan promotions or salary increases for your individual employees, then of course you need to make sure that the budget constraints are met. And this is typically then covered here in this part of our content with these bottom-up or detailed planning applications. With a content package, we basically address different kinds of personas in the organization. So typically you have people from the controlling department involved who will provide central cost rates, like for example, what are the midpoint salaries, what are cost drivers, like for example, certain overhead rates, and these can also be then maintained in the solution. You have then for the aggregated or top-down planning, you typically have the HR business partner for the head of the business unit, where you can then plan for your whole business unit, the target FTEs or the number of new hires you want to do in your organization. And then for the bottom-up part, you have typically the HR business partner who plans then directly on individual employee level. And you have also the cost center manager who's then interested in the results from a financial perspective. So he or she might also then be interested in the results of this content package. And then from a reporting perspective, of course, we also provide here certain reports or templates, which can then be consumed by the CFO or by the chief HR officer, so that you can actually then compare the financial numbers to your budget, or if you have certain diversity KPIs, you can also then look into these reports. Since we want to integrate into other functional areas, and this is actually the basic idea behind this XP&A concept, that once you have done your specific line of business planning, or here your functional planning in the HR domain, then you also want to integrate, with other functional areas of your organization, like for example, with finance in particular. And here we provide also an optional integration. So the content is primarily built targeting people in the HR organization who plan typically on, let's say, headcounts and FTE values on their organizational structures. And typical data sources are here really your transactional HR system like SuccessFactors Employee Central, where we also then source the data from. So typically the master data and the transactional data. But SAC in general is also very open. So if customers have different, let's say, HR systems, you might also source data from these systems. But the content is, of course, built in a way and also provides certain predefined integration jobs with SuccessFactors Employee Central so that SuccessFactors customers can easily activate the content in SAC and load the data from SuccessFactors. So, and then once, let's say, the whole HR planning process is done, so you have finalized your headcount planning and you have derived all the related personal expenses, then you can, as an optional step, also integrate or transfer these data into your regular cost center planning module. So in SAC, we also provide a content package called Integrated Financial Planning, which covers all the standard financial planning activities like cost center planning, financial statement planning, and so on. And here we integrate with a dedicated application, which allows you to transfer the data from your workforce planning model into your financial planning model. And in order to do so, of course, you need to set up certain mappings. So typically on the HR domain, you deal with things like pay components or pay component groups. And typically these go then to your respective GL accounts. And if you want to do this transfer, you need to set up here mappings. Basically you set up which cost components go into which GL accounts. And once this is set up, you can basically automatically transfer the results of your workforce plan into your regular cost center planning model. But this is optional, so there is no prerequisite having S4 or anything in place. If customers have this set up, then of course you can also leverage the integration provided here with the business content. So then let's navigate to the business content. As you might know, the content is then basically directly available in your tenant. And once it's activated, you will find then the assets here in your file repo. So here in our case, I now search for HXM for Human Experience Management. And then we basically have here a folder, once you have activated the content, with all the assets for the workforce planning content. And we leverage here heavily the analytics designer because there are some, let's say, workflows or use cases in the planning process where you can leverage the functionalities. Like, for example, when you want to create a new position, we want to provide the user a nice dialogue where you can have drop-down boxes to set up the position attributes and so on. And here we heavily leverage the functionalities provided by the analytics designer. What you can also see is that we built out the content in a very modular way. So we didn't put everything into one big application, but we tried to split it into the different, let's say, sub-processes or parts of this whole process. So we have here applications, let's say, for internal workforce planning, but also for, let's say, contingent workforce planning, and the detailed and the aggregated planning are also separated. So in that way, the whole content is built in a very modular way. So if you want to then replace certain parts, or if you, let's say, implement your own data entry sheets, for example, you can, of course, then also do it in a more easier way. Also, when it comes to customization later on, this is also then, or the whole maintenance and customization is done in a more simplified way. And so now I'm clicking here on this overview application. So this provides here then the landing page for the individual personas who are involved here in this planning process. So what we can see here in the floor plan, we have three different areas of the content. So we have here a configuration area where you can set up certain cost drivers, like, let's say, for example, the midpoint salaries for certain job families, or let's say the overhead values, like for example, car allowances per FTE or social contribution rate or things like this. So this would be, let's say, the configuration part where, for example, a controlling manager or a controller would go in and maintain these cost drivers. And once this is done, the planner will actually work here with these applications, which are linked here in the middle. So we have here an application for internal planning and external workforce planning. And then we have here an application where people can do this detailed planning. So they can basically go down to the individual employees and do these salary adjustments or plan also new positions. And then we have here a section where you can link to the reports. So we have provided this kind of some standard reports. But typically, you can also, of course, adjust it or bring your own reports here into this content. So now let's start looking into this first application. So now let's say I'm an HR business manager responsible for a whole organization, like a business unit or a division, and here I want to plan then on a very highly aggregated level the number of people in my organization. We see this here in this table. Now we're looking at a combination of company code, business unit, division, and then I see here in my aggregated plan version, I see then the number of people in these respective organizational units. As said, this is a very highly aggregated perspective. We can change here also this aggregation levels or this planning levels. We have predefined some common aggregation levels, like you can see we have here company code, business unit, division, or we can go to company code, business unit, or we can plan by company code, business unit, and job family. And of course, this list can be extended and can be also customized. So if people want to plan on a different aggregation level, then it's quite easy to enhance it. But we have also provided these as like the standard planning levels. And then, of course, I can start changing here my headcount values. So for example, if I now pick this company code, or I can also, of course, filter this down. So let's say we want to now filter here on this best run subsidiary in Germany. Then the table, of course, is here adjusted. We see then the different business units and the divisions. And then I can, let's say, change here, for example, the people working in manufacturing. So if you want to increase these numbers, let's say we want to start hiring people in manufacturing, then I can just enter those values here in the table. What is then also done is you can also see this reflected here in the charts. And here we can also then compare against existing versions. So for example, if you have already a budget in place, you can then compare against this budget, both on a headcount budget as well as on a cost, so on a monetary perspective. And we can also, of course, then once we have changed here the values, we can recalculate the costs and then see also what would be the financial impact of the changes to my plan. So here we can then also drill down. So we can see then the HR expenses over time. And I can also then drill down into the different cost components. As I mentioned, so typically on the HR side, so you have several cost components, like you have your base salaries, and then you have all sorts of different overheads, like here, for example, social insurance contributions to a pension fund, and so on and so forth. And these values are calculated here with a certain business logic we provide out of the box, but this business logic, of course, can then also be individually customized and adjusted to the individual needs. In addition, you can then also, besides these automated calculated values, you can also manually adjust it. So if you say that I want to adjust a certain number, so for example, if I know that some of the overheads needs to be adjusted, then I can have here this additional column and put in, let's say, my manual offsets I wanna put in here on this combination. So this would be, let's say, the part of the business content, which deals more with these top-down target settings. So again, here we are planning on a very aggregated level. And the idea is that, let's say the HR business partner for a certain business unit comes in and sets here the overall targets for the next year. We can do the same also for our external workers. So here it's a very, let's say, simplified version. We can also assume that, of course, if you look into really contingent worker planning, there might be more to this, but this is more meant to be a starting point so that you just not focus only on your internal workforce, but you have also here the possibility to consider some impacts with your contingent workforce. Again, first step would be that you define here your planning level, so your level of detail you want to plan on. And then here for external workers, we have here also the location in, because there might be different, let's say, cost rates for external workers by location. And here we can then also apply the changes. So we can, let's say, increase our number of external people in this particular location. And then the same, let's say, game applies, we can recalculate the cost. And in this case, of course, certain external cost rates would be taken from our configuration screen and would be applied here so that we can then also calculate the cost of our external workforce and compare it to the budget. So once this top-down or aggregated planning is done, so this can also be then taken as a standalone package. So some companies, or for some companies, this might be already sufficient for their annual, let's say, headcount planning process. But as I mentioned, this can also be a prerequisite for a detailed planning. So let's say in this aggregated planning part, we set here the top-down targets for the organization. And then at the end, the individual managers for their cost centers will do the bottom-up planning. So now they really plan on their direct reports and on individual position level. And this can be done here in this application, which is actually then here for the detailed employee planning. And here we see in this main table, we see here the individual employees. So here we're going really down to the individual colleagues working here in this in the team. We see here all the relevant attributes of each individual employee, like for example the position, the job family, the location, the pay grade, and so on. And we see then here the employment level. So we see that most employees are working 100%, but we have also some part-time workers only working 50%. And now we can actually plan certain activities for our existing employees. So for example, if the manager wants to plan here an internal transfer or wants to plan a promotion, you can basically pick one of these activities from the list. So let's say we want to, for this colleague, we want to adjust the employment level. Then I basically get here this, dialog box, and here I can change, let's say, the rate of employment to 50%. And I say, okay, this is, for example, this could be maternity leave, and it starts in May, and it's basically going till end of October. And then the system will apply this change. And of course, in the background, we will also recalculate the cost, because when you adjust your employment level, then of course you typically also get less salary. And this is then also recalculated applying the business logic, which is provided here in the content. And once this is done, we can see the results here in the table, both on the, FTE values, as well as on the cost side. We can basically see the adjusted values. So we see that those numbers here have changed. So starting in May until end of October, and we will also see then the adjusted costs here in our cost table. So here we have actually the same structure. So in the top table, we have here the FTE and headcount values. And here in the bottom table, we have the associated costs. And we can now see that for this colleague, since we adjusted here the FTE level, We have also, of course, or we see here adjusted costs. And again, we can also see the breakdowns into the different pay components, like the base salaries and the overheads and so on. Again, I can also here manually adjust it. So for example, if a company has a concept like, for example, certain extracurricular bonuses like spot awards and stuff like this, then you can also use this and manually adjust here the values for the salaries, for example. Besides planning here on the existing workforce, we can also create new positions. So this means if I switch here to the perspective for new hires, we see here the open positions. So we have here already planned one open position, which is about to start in August. And now I can actually plan additional positions if I click here on this create position. And here, let's say we want to hire a new JavaScript developer. And then I can also provide here all the relevant attributes for this new position. For example, we can say what is the desired pay grade. So let's say we want to hire here a junior coming from the university. Job family should be engineering and technical. And then we're looking for a full-time position. And we plan to create this position, let's say in September. And then same applies. So if I click on done, then this new position would be created. So we will create new master data here in our planning model. And the related costs are calculated. So we have here a certain midpoint salary for this combination of job family, pay grade, and here location. So if I also specify here the company code, then of course we might have here a different impact on our cost than if we create, let's say, the position in a different location, like for example in the Middle East or in Eastern Europe or in Asia. So here, of course, you can also then see what's the impact on your cost, whether you are still in budget, and do also these kind of simulations. So this would be the application for, let's say, this new position or this individual or detailed planning scenario. So where you really plan on individual employees or on new positions. And the last step, or let's say two more things, which I can show you here. One thing would be the integration into the financial plan, and here a couple of reports. So let's look at the reports first. So here we provide a bunch of stories which show you the most relevant KPIs of this headcount planning exercise. So here we have KPIs, let's say for diversity or also for breakdowns into your job families and locations and so on. And you can also later on track here the progress while implementing this plan. So you can compare then the actuals against your original plan. And this is what we see here on this overview page, or on this progress overview. So we see here some KPIs for your total workforce. So we see the total headcount, we see the percentage of external versus internal workforce, and we see some diversity KPIs. So for example, the ratio of female managers or women in leadership. And then we have here also breakdowns by time. So the headcount number by time. And then we can also compare here to the budget and see then the deviations from the budget. Here on the right-hand side, we have breakdowns of headcount by location, by job family, and job level. And here you can also then see, let's say the structure of your workforce in the different locations and in the different job families. For diversity reporting, we have here then also additional KPIs. So we can see there again, numbers of female workers in our company, also broken down here by different job families and job levels. So you can see here also the seniority and how this is split over male and female. And then we have also some comparison or some related KPIs to our external workforce. Again, we have here breakdowns by roles and by locations. so that you can also see where you have most of your external workforce in which location. And one last step, as I mentioned, so this, so what we have seen now can be completely used in the, let's say, in the HR department or from an HR management perspective. So here we're dealing mostly with HR related KPIs, so with workforce, with headcount, FTE values, and also things like, for example, the pay components. But now, let's say, if you want to really follow this this integrated idea of integrated planning, then the next steps is once you have done this, you want to also transfer this information into your regular financial planning process, so that this information, like the personal expenses, will also go into your financial statements or into your financial statement planning. And for this, we have provided here this integration application, where you can actually then transfer your results of your workforce plan into the financial plan. And here we see also basically two tables. We see here on the first table, we have a view into our workforce planning model. So here we see the cost types. So this would be the pay components from the HR perspective. So we see here the overheads. We see also then, let's say, the base salaries and so on. So these are all the, let's say, more HR-centric cost components. And then typically, if you want to now integrate this into a financial plan, you need to derive the respective GL accounts. And this is actually what we can do here. So we can, of course, this mapping needs to be maintained here in the master data. So for each cost component, we need to maintain the GL account as an attribute. So this is done in the data modeling environment. And once this is done, we can basically derive this and copy this into our financial planning model. And this is what we see here at the bottom. So here we see our GL account structure. So we have in this model, we don't have any of these HR related objects like the job families, the positions, and so on. So this is all aggregated away. But typically we have these more financial driven objects like the company code, the cost center, and of course you have your GL accounts. And here in this GL account structure, you see then that we have here the full P&L covered. So we have here our net income position, and then we have the operating expenses, and of course our employee related expenses will then be written into these line items here under the operating expenses. And once you have done this, of course you can continue with your cost center planning. So you can add other expenses like materials and other overhead costs, and then you can basically come to a full cost center planning, product cost planning, and at the end financial statement planning. And this is actually this optional step. So for customers who really want to go for this integrated approach of planning, then you can leverage here the different content packages SAP provides, both on the finance side as well as on the HR side, and also combine them together and use them in a real integrated way. And with this, let me switch back to my presentation. This was actually here now the last step, which I've shown you. So once you're done here with your workforce plan, you can actually integrate the numbers into your financial plan and continue doing the cost center and the financial statement planning there. And with this, actually we are done with the presentation part. And now I think we have a couple of minutes left for questions and answers.
Thank you, Holger, for your time and demo. Just a reminder to the audience, you can also not only raise your questions in the Q&A tab, but you can also speak up if you like. So just raise your hand and I can unmute you.
I mean, if there are no questions or if you have questions maybe coming up later, then I would like also to refer you to our community site. We have a dedicated area for planning related topics or for SAC in general, but then also for planning related topics. And maybe if you have then questions at a later point in time, you can also then post these questions to our community site, and we will check this site on a regular basis and then also can answer your questions there.
Good hint. All right, then thank you everyone for listening. Thank you, Holger. and see you in one of the next SAP community calls.
Thank you also from my side.